Megan and Jonathan Jordan are newlyweds, living a small town life in southern Mississippi. Both are in their early 20s.
He called me the night before he asked me out. We talked for like 5 hours.
I met Megan in ninth grade math class and just went from there. We dated throughout high school.
We were together for 4 years, and then we got married.
Their pride and joy is their son, Braylon, who surprised them from the start.
I wasn't supposed to have him that day, so they just walked in and was like, do you want to have a baby today? I just looked at Jonathan and I was like, yeah, sure. But it was one of the best days of my life. I was watching TV and the door to our bedroom was open. I heard Braylon start to cough. I thought he was just coughing, like he had something in his throat. And then I heard him vomit. I ran to the bedroom and Jonathan was holding him up. I went and got some towels and wet washcloths to wash his face off. I thought he had a stomach virus and was throwing up because of the virus.
Stomach viruses are one of the most common ailments to afflict young children. In extreme cases, they can leave a child severely dehydrated.
I took him to the living room and watched more TV. I continued to give him liquids and tried to get him to go to sleep, but he wasn't having it. He was antsy and he wouldn't sleep. And he just continued throwing everything up that I tried to give him.
5 hours after the vomiting started, Megan finally coaxes her son to sleep.
I was trying to sign us in and Braylon started to pass out. His head fell back and his eyes rolled back in his head and his body just kind of went limp. It was like he wasn't there. I was really, really scared. I didn't even know how to ask for help. I didn't know whether I should run into the ER or just wait for somebody to come get me.
A nurse notices her distress and rushes Braylon and Megan into an examination room.
And I'm sitting there not knowing what to do because he's not responsive. It was really hard. I was really scared. I didn't know if he was going to be okay.
Doctors place the comatose boy on an intravenous drip, and Megan calls Jonathan to come to the hospital.
When I got there, my baby was laid out on the bed, and Megan was crying.
Doctors x-ray Braylon.
I just laying down on the table and he's whining because he don't want to lay down. So we're telling him, let's just take a picture real quick and get this over with. So I held his hand and they snapped a picture.
And as soon as they took the x-ray, a picture showed up on the computer. I noticed what was in his stomach. My heart sank.
I knew something was wrong before she even said anything.
Jonathan turns to the monitor.
All you seen was 8 little white balls.
I said, I know what those are. They were magnetic beads.
Magnetic beads are a popular office toy, marketed to adults as a stress reliever. The x-ray shows Braylon has swallowed 8.
We kind of just looked at each other and didn't understand.
We didn't let him play with them. We didn't give them to him. How did he find these? And how did he swallow them without us knowing?
Jonathan went home and he looked around. They were in the cabinet that we kept them in, but 8 were gone. Some must have just rolled away while we were playing with them, and somehow Braylon got them.
We kind of put all the blame on us. How did we let this happen?
It was really hard because we felt like we were the reason that Braylon was sick. We were the reason that he was going through the pain because we bought them.
Doctors transfer Braylon to a children's hospital in New Orleans. There, pediatric gastroenterologist Dr. Adam Knoll and his team whisk the ailing boy into the operating room for intestinal surgery.
We had no idea that this type of magnet could cause this much damage. He had holes in several parts of his intestine where the magnet beads had caused tissue breakdown. I was very concerned about that.
And we're all just waiting there in the waiting room, not knowing what's going on or if he's okay.
We were scared.
And we prayed together, which is not something we normally do.
And now the surgeon tells Braylon's parents that although he has removed the magnetic beads, the subsequent tears in the boy's intestines have led to a serious infection.
Infections can cause something called septic shock.
Septic shock can occur when bacteria inside the intestines contaminate the bloodstream, potentially leading to organ failure.
Some children, when they go into septic shock, will die. And Braylon was septic.
All I could do was cry because it was so unfair that it was happening. And it made me really scared. And I was hurting for him. And I just wanted him to be okay.
Septic shock is not Braylon's only problem.
He had lost blood supply to his intestine. And because of that, the intestine was no longer viable.
The surgeons must remove almost all of Braylon's small intestine.
That is a huge loss. That's just not something that is trivial. I mean, that is a major, major league surgery and a major league post-surgical problem.
Without 90% of his small intestine, Braylon can no longer absorb nutrition naturally through his digestive system.
He's lost his intestine. So you're not going to be able to feed this child by mouth now. So now you need to put in big catheters, lines into the major vessels to give him nutrition. Because now he needs all of his nutrition given by vein.
And this intervention leaves Braylon vulnerable to harmful infections.
And so all those plastic elements that you put into the body, bacteria can attach to those, and those can become infected, and you need to replace those. Where we didn't know if Braylon was going to make it. I mean, he was literally hanging on to life by a string.
It was really difficult going moment by moment, wondering if today was the day that you would lose your son.
Braylon remains in a coma while doctors use broad-spectrum antibiotics to fight his septic shock. Slowly, the infection subsides. Then, 32 days after first arriving at the hospital, the doctors take Braylon off life support.
He opened his eyes and he couldn't talk because he had a breathing tube through it down his neck. But he opened his eyes and he realized it was us and he wanted us to hold him.
That was seriously the best day of my life.
Against dramatic odds, Braylon survives.
Goodness, Braylon! Look at you!
And after another month in the hospital, Jonathan and Megan finally take him home.
The day we left the hospital was amazing. We just sit him in his car seat. He's so happy. And we're like, are you ready to go home? And he just like busts out laughing, like he's so excited.
Today, Braylon is back to his animated self, playing with his toy cars and enjoying the outdoors. But with only 10% of his intestines intact, the magnets have left their mark.
He has to have this tube that goes through his skin into his blood vessels that supplies his nutrition.
Today, Braylon wears a little book bag and holds all of his vitamins and everything he needs to survive.
Braylon acts like his backpack is a part of him. It doesn't bother him, and he's comfortable with it.
Though Braylon's long-term health requires future surgical procedures, Megan and Jonathan remain hopeful.
Braylon is the reason I wake up every day. He makes me happy. Even when he's bad, he makes me happy.